Shri Rashesh Shah, sorry, is Sunil Sangai, Shilpa Kumar, Jyoti, participants, ladies and gentlemen. I thank the organizers for inviting me here, and I do remember last year also being present in this conference when I was in Ministry of Finance. And I must admit, last year also when I was in the government and now in SEBI, the general perception is this conference is taken seriously and it has grown in stature and credibility. And I must at the outset mention that and thank FICCI and organizers for achieving this general perception and idea which people feel. Now, India remains a bright spot among major economies. Shri Shah and Shri Sangai has already talked about stable macroeconomic fundamentals, political stability, structural reforms, and how the present government in the last 3 years plus has been constantly endeavoring towards bringing more reforms in a remarkably focused manner. So that's something which has already been said. Though I must mention one important thing which is engaging attention of government in RBI and SEBI also is playing a proactive role, is about twin balance sheet issue which was raised some years back, 2 years back I think, in the economic survey by Chief Economic Advisor, and that remains yet to be resolved, although many efforts are being put into place, and that is one reason which is inhibiting private sector investments. So that is one issue which is being addressed, and I feel that all regulators have to collectively work towards resolving that issue. Some of the importance of market-based financing, I think this also has been touched by previous speakers, and as to benefit of market-based financing vis-a-vis banks, it's not really vis-a-vis supplementing the bank financing. Banks naturally will continue to play a very major dominant role in financial markets, but how capital markets can work and further strengthen the financial system, that's something which is really coming up, and this is really encouraging as I speak about certain figures later that will emerge, that the capital markets have really come of age, and is really a very, very thing to be proud of. Now, so the broader trends in the primary market, if I may say, public offer of equity, the total capital raised by way of public offer equity shares in 2016-17 was 32,520 crore from about 9,790 crore in 2013-14. That is a growth of about 70%. There is a huge growth in the public offer of equity and the money being raised through public offers. The current year promises even much more action, and the various estimates which are being projected by various consultants and various agencies. So we'll see as we progress where we end. But the actual numbers till now, they themselves are quite encouraging. Till now, amount raised is rupees 9452 crore, and IPOs of over rupees 50,000 crore have been filed with SEBI. So the trend is very good, and I'm sure by end of this year, they'll be raising through IPOs will all be perhaps all-time high, at least in the recent times. Now, exit opportunity for existing shareholders. What we find is that higher proportion of recent equity public offerings are by way of offer for sale, and size of OFS in IPOs has been increasing from 2012 to 2016-17. During the same time period, the size of OFS as a percentage of size of IPOs increased from 19.5% to 34%. This broadly indicates that the public markets in Australia are also providing viable exit opportunities to the existing investors. Now, the issue of buybacks and dividends, we have noticed, and you also must have noticed, that the number of buybacks have really taken a jump, and 52 companies made buybacks offers in 2016-17 vis-a-vis 9 companies about 2 years back. Of course, partly it is encouraged by the tax benefits vis-a-vis dividends, which was there in the last budget. But more importantly, which I won't really say I mean, I leave it to the audience to judge, is that we found that the capital that was returned back to shareholders in the form of dividend buyback was about 1.5 times the amount raised through equity capital in 2016-17. So though equity capital raised was pretty impressive last year, but the amount which went back to investors was 1.5 times. So this somehow shows that in 16-17 more money was returned back to investors as against money being raised from investors, and possibly reflective of constrained investment opportunities that may be available to the corporates, which I am sure will really improve in times to come. Let's see this year how many new IPOs really come. Now coming to the corporate bonds, it is I must admit that it is not only equity capital being raised in the market that has moved up. The amount raised through corporate bonds has also shown an equally upward trend, with the amount being raised increasing to rupees 6.7 lakh crore in 2016-17 as compared to rupees 3.78 crore in 2013. That is an increase of 77% over this time period. So last year, I remember this conference focused on corporate bond, increasing liquidity in corporate bond, and if the figures of 2016-17 are any indication, we are in fact moving in the right direction, and a substantial amount of debt for the corporates are being raised through bond market, which should be the right way to raise money, especially for infrastructure projects and funds and the projects which require funding over a long duration. So this is a very encouraging trend too. Now, Mr. Shah mentioned about trend in mutual fund investments. This actually has been quite encouraging, and we now are finding like mutual funds with around 20 lakh crore as AUM is almost 1/5 of the banking system. So it's really very encouraging, and it's almost, you know, it is like backbone of investment mechanism in capital markets. So they have doubled in the last 3 years AUM, which is very, very encouraging. And what is more encouraging is that inflows to equity-oriented mutual funds has shown an upward trend, moving from a scenario of negative net inflows in 2013-14 to consistent positive net flows of more than rupees 70,000 crore in each of the last three financial years. So that's a very good indication, and that shows that individual participation in mutual funds is increasing, whether through SIPs or otherwise, which we find very encouraging. But as Mr. Shah rightly pointed out, I must actually admit that as mutual fund industry grows and mature, they need to constantly evolve even greater governance norms so as to sustain their operations and keep the faith and trust of investors. He talked about product suitability and bringing down the cost. Of course, this doesn't only apply to mutual funds, but in capital markets, this applies to each of the product, and I think it is in everyone's interest to see that suitable progress is made in this direction. That will actually ensure sustainability of growth in the capital markets. Now, some of the challenges and way forward, some of the ideas. We feel that if the public markets have to sustain the current and enhanced capital raising efforts, it is important that markets continue to satisfy some of the broad conditions. Some of the broad ones will include the standards of conduct in market for all stakeholders, that is intermediaries, merchant bankers, issuers, auditors, etc., has to further strengthen and be benchmarked to the best in the world. Secondly, integrity of the market should be non-negotiable so that it gives a high degree of comfort and confidence to investors. And thirdly, there should be adequate competition with frictionless ease of doing business for all stakeholders. So these are some of the broad issues which need to be addressed, and I will like to dwell upon them slightly in detail. Now, on high standards of conduct in the market, as I think Mr. Sangai said about it, one is on corporate governance, and this is an extremely important subject. We actually feel in SEBI that much needs to be done, and it's not something that's only should be a boardroom discussion or a drawing room discussion as to this subject, because everyone has been discussing it. We are very serious that issues which enhance the participation of minority shareholders or protect their rights. Issues like independence of independent directors and their active participation functioning of the company, improving safeguards and disclosure with respect to related party transactions, and enhancing the evaluation and accountability of the board are some of the issues which need to be seriously gone into. And suitable ways be put in place to ensure that they are adhered to. That could be a mix of principle-based and rule-based regulation, but these are something which we feel have to be there if there has to be sustainability of capital markets growth in this country. So we had set up a committee under Sri Uday Kotak in June 2017, and they are deliberating on some of these issues, and we expect report by end of this month. And I can only say that this will not be a routine sort of a committee or recommendation. We really will go into this and see what improvements can be brought in, of course, in consultation with all stakeholders. The stewardship code is another very, very important issue. Now, data shows that markets are increasingly becoming institutionalized. Shareholders of both mutual fund and FPIs and Nifty index companies has increased from about 17% in 2010 to 25%. Recently. At the same time, the share of promoters for the same set of companies has declined from 57.3% to 46.1%, with share of institutional investors increasing as reflected by the sample of index companies. There is a need for it to play an increasing role in the governance of their investee companies. This calls for an effective stewardship code. A beginning has been made by SEBI in this regard, and mutual funds actually have been asked to disclose their voting policies and procedures. And after this was put in place, it is heartening to note that mutual funds are actively participating by voting in the decisions making process of the management of the companies where they are invested by using their votes and not abstaining. Though it is for mutual funds, the system has been put in place, and as I said, that seems to be working better, which needs further improvement but has started. Similar sort of norms need to be put for other, although insurance IRDA regulator also has recently put some norms, but SEBI would want to have uniform norms for all institution investors in companies, because we feel that if they have substantial holding in any company, they should actively play part in the board management. So we should apply to insurance funds, pension funds, and even foreign portfolio investors. So we are in the process of formulating guidelines in that. Coming to the market integrity, we recognize that prevention of market manipulation by fraudulent and unfair trade practices and prevention of insider trading are important for sustaining investors' confidence. During 2016-17, SEBI took up 193 cases of market manipulation, price rigging, and issue related manipulations, and completed 123 such cases. As far as violation of prevention of insider trading is concerned, SEBI took up 34 cases and completed 15 cases during 2016-17. We recognize that more needs to be done on these two fronts, and we have recently constituted a committee on fair market conduct under Sri T.K. Vishwanathan, ex-Law Secretary, Government of India. The terms of reference of the committee include the identification of opportunities for improvement with respect to handling of unpublished price sensitive information during takeovers, trading plans, and aligning insider trading regulations to Companies Act provisions. So this company has also been requested to give their report within a period of 4 months. So this is another committee which we are seriously looking for their recommendations and working forward on that. We feel that integrity of markets can be further strengthened by timely, adequate, and proactive disclosures. So one of the important decisions which was taken by SEBI, which I'm sure you are aware, was to bring in a requirement for listed entities to disclose to the stock exchanges the default in corporate bonds and bank loans within one working day. Such disclosures would be required to be made for defaults on payment of interest, repayment of principal amount on loans from banks and financial institutions, debt securities, etc. This will become effective from 1st October 2017. While this face of it, it may look like a routine sort of an action, but I need not dwell into this. I'm sure the audience here appreciate the significance of this decision and the resultant discipline likely to bring on timely repayment of debt by debtors. Now come to the issue of ease of doing business, which industry through various industrialisations, through FICCI and other associations always keep on striving for, and rightly so. Here the issue is that market regulators have to constantly struggle or try to maintain a fine balance between ease of doing business for corporates and ensuring investor protection. While maintaining investors' protection is non-negotiable, simplification, rationalization of regulations need to be a constant endeavor. So we realize that, and we have constituted a group to examine various regulations of SEBI and redraft them to simplify the language and to rationalize various regulations. One of the important ones, the basic, the first, one of the first regulations of SEBI is on capital and disclosure requirements, which is being looked into, and being in a time-bound manner, we will come out with a draft and finalize in consultation with stakeholders, the purpose being to simplify the language and so that it can be operationalized easily. We in fact recently, as you are aware, also allowed relaxation in issue ICDR and takeover regulations. With respect to stress assets, because we found that these regulations may prove to be onerous one for potential investors for stress assets. And this is one example where we coordinated with government and RBI. And as I said, that resolution of NPA is something which everyone has to contribute, and this I thought was in the right direction. SEBI has also simplified KYC norms in recent years, and now SEBI is working towards operationalization of central KYC in consultation with government and RBI, and this would be put into operation soon. Mr. Sangai talked of paperless working, so I am happy to say that SEBI has recently introduced a platform for online registration of intermediaries with a view to automate the registration process and making it simpler. So I'd like to get a feedback. In fact, SEBI would like to have a feedback as to how this platform is working, whether it needs further improvements. We are also in the process of finalizing common registration form for FPIs in consultation with government and RBI. Mr. Sangai mentioned about e-notes and the restrictions put on that. Simultaneously, we want to simplify FPI registration and participation by FPI in capital markets. So simultaneously we are doing both the things. Now I think I already spoke, coming to some of the issues as closing remarks, I think materiality of disclosure is essential, and there has to be balance between overburdening the corporates with too many disclosures and the disclosures which are material in nature, of course they should be maintained. So we are looking for various formats in the listing regulations and other regulations as to what are the disclosures being sought and how that information is being used for analysis and for the examination. It should not be undue, unnecessary burden, but materiality should be maintained, and we look for suggestions in that. Other issue which has been raised by my previous speakers, the deepening the market requires increasing the volume of floating stocks in the market further. One thing is that this is likely to improve with the number of IPOs lined up for listing. And another related issue is meeting the mandatory requirement of 25% minimum public shareholding by listed companies. We note that more than 25 listed PSUs are yet to comply with this requirement, for whom the deadline was recently extended by the government up to August 2018. These PSUs need to timely plan to ensure compliance in time, and I think this is an opportune time for anyone who wishes to go for further divestment, and I'm sure these PSUs will avail of this opportunity. One important item which I wish to state, I think we have stated earlier also, SEBI, and I just want to use this opportunity to state it again, that is sanctity of financial statements. That is those we find, that is the key for market integrity, as also to give confidence to the investors. And here comes the crucial role of auditors. Auditors are market gatekeepers, and all stakeholders depend on their audit findings to make their investment decisions. Auditors therefore need to reflect on their role and influence with regard to development of capital market. I think this is extremely important. On cyber security threats, that's another evolving area of concern for regulators, not only in India but elsewhere too. SEBI is aware of this and has laid down a detailed framework with regard to cyber security and cyber resilience that market infrastructure institutions are required to adopt. SEBI has also constituted a high power steering committee on cyber security, comprising experts to provide overall guidance in cyber security initiatives and to advise SEBI in developing and maintaining cyber security and cyber resilience requirements aligned with global best practices in industry. Now, application of technology in financial markets called FinTech is changing the way financial markets traditionally have functioned. Technology is affecting financial markets in various ways. With technology-driven revolution in financial markets, regulators are faced with newer challenges as well as opportunities to evolve their functioning and more effectively through adoption of new technology solutions. With a view to reaping the opportunities provided by FinTech, as also to deal with relevant risk and challenges, SEBI has set up another committee under chairmanship of Shri T.V. Mohandas Pai. And the committee inter alia would examine and deliberate and advise SEBI on an ongoing basis on issues like use of FinTech for further deepening of securities market, global developments in FinTech space, and consequent opportunities and challenges for India and ways to harness FinTech efficiently. I note that this day-long conference will have sessions on various topics ranging from increasing market depth, divestment in PSUs, competition commission issues, infrastructure financing, cyber security, etc. I wish the conference fruitful and meaningful deliberations, and SEBI will look forward to the recommendations which this conference made for further deepening of capital markets. Thank you very much.